I have been doing these videos for a while now, and we are finally going to say goodbye to Dylan's acoustic period. We are at the final song, and it's a masterpiece of Another Side of Bob Dylan, the song, of course, being It Ain't Me, Babe, and the next album marking his transition from folk star to rock star, when he, of course, does half of the songs acoustic and half electric. But back to this song, and we really should focus on it, not just because it's the point of the video, but because it's so great. And it's also very efficient. This is a relatively short song, clocking in at 3 minutes and 34 seconds, and it only has 223 words. Consider that the last song, also a breakup song, Ballad in Plain D, you know, by universal consensus, an inferior song to the one we're going to talk about today, is 8 minutes and 18 seconds, and about twice as many words. Yet today's song has pretty much an infinitely bigger impact. It's also pretty simple in structure. There's only three stanzas, you know, three verses, with kind of an embedded refrain within each of them. But back to the verses themselves, they all follow the same rhyme scheme. That rhyme scheme, however, does have quite a bit going on. I'm not even sure if this picture from my spreadsheet comes through very well, but it's what I used. And the bottom line, in case you're curious, is of those 12 lines, remember every section is always 12 lines, it's lines 2 and 4 that rhyme, then 6 and 8, and then 9 and 12. And that final pairing in each section, each stanza, lines 9 and 12, always ends with the or sound. Someone who will die for you and more, but it ain't me, babe. No, 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 it ain't me, babe. It ain't me you're looking for, babe. And that's the thing about the word babe. The instances of that word cause kind of a secondary layer on top of the, I guess what I would consider, main rhyme scheme. It's in the song a lot, 13 times, and in the title, and it plays kind of this mischievous role. The or sound that anchors the ending of every stanza, every final set of four lines. That dynamic is really crucial to the song, but it's overlaid by the fact that the last three lines in every stanza are babe, babe, babe. That is, in my opinion, why Dylan always has a pause on the final line of each stanza before he says babe. It ain't me you're looking for, babe. He's got to let that four linger out there so it can rhyme with its bookend from earlier. And then it's used in other parts of the song in other ways, like here, where it's the opening rhyme, ending lines 1 and 3 with no underlying rhyme beneath it. But for all that, this is a very simple and straightforward song. And that's a big part of how it generates its considerable power. We've talked before about how love songs are probably the most common type of song in history. Additionally, I'd say it's the low-hanging fruit in terms of songwriting. It's the easiest kind of song to write. And generations of songwriting hacks have taken advantage of that fact. Oh, if each of us just had a nickel for every time we had to listen to a music factory, assembly line, cliche-ridden, inauthentic, you know, no real emotion behind it whatsoever, empty-calorie love song. Why are there always so many of them? For the same reason factory-produced, cliche-ridden sitcoms and brain-dead-slash-brain-killing reality shows dominate television over quality programming in terms of pure numbers. And back to songwriting, not that there aren't great love songs, of course there are, and Dylan has written many of them, but it's still a case of downhill running like friendly territory. If it's hard to write a great love song, and I'm sure that it's very difficult, but if it is, I think it's that much harder to write a great anti-love song like It Ain't Me, Babe. Dylan, seen here working on some of his sculptures, lays bare his soul, and it's easier to do that when you're in love. Hey everybody, look how in love I am. It's a much, much braver thing to say, hey, look how in love I'm not anymore with this person. And no, I don't want to be her knight in shining armor. Dylan, as far as I can ascertain, invented this subgenre of songwriting. And just to make it even more impressive, it's 100% personal and authentic. This is pure confession. It's not him imagining a character going through this kind of a thing, which would still be, you know, an impressive feat. But it's like House of the Rising Sun, for instance. And yes, of course, I know the Animals did not, you know, create that song. And no one knows when the original was written, but I would say it's all but certain when the original was written, it was not an actual confessional. It was an imagined character from an imagined story. So Dylan is breaking ground in multiple ways with this song and songs like it. For instance, obviously, Don't Think Twice, It's All Right. As that song is, though, it lacks this, yeah, I really don't want to be that for you vibe. This complete antithesis to the stereotypical love song that today's song is and embodies. So a lot of artists picked up on this and jumped on this song, including Johnny Cash and June Carter, and Joan Baez, who sang it on her own and with Dylan. Bit ironic when it comes to the duet, given the future of their relationship, of course. Turtles, who were a big deal back in the day. So from big-time musical acts back when the song first came out and thereafter, to of-the-moment current pop stars like Miley Cyrus, who has taken the song out on the road, to Kesha, is that how you pronounce her name, who does, I must admit, a goosebump-inducing version, or did, at the 2016 Billboard Music Awards. It's got a sparse, beautiful accompaniment, just a piano and a violin, just fantastic job by whoever arranged that rendition. I'm assuming that wasn't her, but hey, maybe it was. And anyway, the point is, this song has definitely resonated across time. Speaking of which, we have to go back in time again, so back and forth and back, because we cannot talk about the impact of this song without mentioning that it indirectly spurred one of the biggest hits of its day. And funny enough, this anti-love song was flipped on its head, so it went anti-anti and turned back into a love song, kind of, sort of, by Sonny Bono, who wrote Sonny and Cher's enduring hit I Got You, Babe, using Dylan's song as inspiration. Now, though, let's go back to the beginning and ask the question we often ask in this video series, how did Dylan come up with this song? Well, most agree this goes back to Miss Rodolo, who you saw pictured with Dylan earlier, yet again, just like with our last song and others we've covered in this series. She was muse number one for early acoustic Dylan. She had famously, within Dylanology, whatever circles, gone away to Italy against Dylan's wishes, giving us Boots of Spanish Leather, as well as a lyric he inserted into House Carpenter. And the story is Dylan actually went looking for her in Italy and wrote this song, today's song, as part of that whole episode and failure. And we know Bob will often take an existing song as his model. It seems pretty clear he did here. And to talk about it, let's briefly meet John Jacob Niles, an interesting and accomplished man, as you'll see based on the brief synopsis that's showing up at the bottom of the screen. And meanwhile, what a swath of history he saw. Born 1892 and died in 1980. He wrote a song called Go Away From My Window, which obviously gives Dylan's song its opening line and launching point. That being said, it doesn't give It Ain't Me, Babe its quintessential element. Go Away From My Window is more like his love is leaving him, and she's maybe concerned about him. You know, the old, like, are you gonna be okay vibe? And he's like, get out of here. So a much more conventional songwriting dynamic. Oh, by the way, and he says it's based on a true incident. To be clear, I wasn't claiming earlier Dylan was the first songwriter in history to write about something personal, something directly from his life. Speaking of taking things, some people also say Sleepy John Estes's Drop Down Mama was an influence here, because it contains the line, go away from my window, quit scratching on my screen. But that seems like more of a coincidence. The John Jacob Niles song is clearly the starting point for It Ain't Me, Babe. Meanwhile, neither Estes nor Niles are actually the first person to ever come up with this device. It surely has much older roots in both poetry and folk music, as discussed here. And regardless, that's how the song begins. And speaking of the beginning, let's get to it. Go away from my window, leave at your own chosen speed. I'm not the one you want, babe. I'm not the one you need. Notice that the word babe is not needed there at all. Could have just been, leave at your own chosen speed. I'm not the one you want. I'm not the one you need. That works perfectly well. It's not there to set up a future rhyme, nothing. But it's like the most important word in the song. It appears early and, as we said, often. It's like each time he uses it, it's this little stab. Dylan takes this very standard relationship term, back then, today, and kind of corrupts it. Of course, it's supposed to denote affection, and importantly, not just in a general sense, it then and now specifically means the person you're in love with in a relationship. But in this song, it's like this barb that's reminding her every time he says it how the relationship is actually over. And the song is basically defined by how it wields all of its words like a knife, not just that one. I'm not the one you want, babe. I'm not the one you need. Just cutting right to the heart of the matter, and look at the setup for that rhyme there. leave at your own chosen speed. Even that one little line seems full of the kind of casual, heartless dismissal that the song is based on. It seems to be saying, you know, walk away slowly, run away from here, from this window, from me, I really don't care. I love how the song just tears into conventional, mundane love song dynamics that are just so full of it too, you know? Like the song When a Man Loves a Woman. It's a fine song, it's a classic, but let's examine a piece of it. He'd give up all his comforts and sleep out in the rain if she said that's the way it ought to be. No, he wouldn't. And neither would she. There's not one person who has ever heard this song who would actually go outside and spend the night sleeping outdoors in the rain because their husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend told them to. Dylan, meanwhile, is saying, you say you're looking for someone never weak but always strong to protect you and defend you, whether you are right or wrong. Someone to open each and every door, but it ain't me, babe. And then he kind of hammers away with the word no. No, no, no. It ain't me, babe. It ain't me you're looking for. And of course he does that at the end of every verse. Just that little detail, the use of the word no, over and over. Let me be perfectly clear. There's no chance I wanted to be that person for you. Let's speed things up and get all the way through the middle of the song. Go lightly from the ledge, babe. Go lightly on the ground. I'm not the one you want, babe. I'll only let you down. You say you're looking for someone who will promise never to part. Someone to close his eyes for you. Someone to close his heart. Someone who will die for you and more. But it ain't me, babe. And then the standard closing four lines. That verse starts with the line, go lightly from the ledge, babe, has that nice alliteration, of course. And if you notice the L sound, it's not just twice, it's three times. Because the word lightly has the L sound twice just within itself. So go lightly from the ledge. And of course, he starts the next line the same way, go lightly. So the L sound is the engine there. It appears five times in those two very short lines. And you might have noticed when I was reading there the line, I will only let you down. That's how it shows up in print, but he actually sings it, I'll only let you down. I think that's an improvement. It's more direct, and I'll only let you down. Ouch. This is the mature and painful honesty Dylan brings to a relationship song as opposed to the schmaltzy and empty promises. By the way, we might notice that I will only let you down, L, followed immediately by looking for someone. You always get lots and lots of returning sounds with Dylan and not just at the ends of lines. Does he think consciously of that when he's writing a lyric? I doubt it. Even further down, same stanza, someone to close his eyes for you, someone to close his heart. It's just the kind of thing that once you notice and hear, you can't unhear. Every time I hear this song and this part of the song, that stands out to me. It kind of just drives me through. They're like peaks on a wave graph or something. Someone who will die for you and more. And anyway, the easier, far easier thing to notice and remark upon are how devastating these lines are, right? Speaking of honesty, someone to close his eyes for you, someone to close his heart. Is the song's narrator saying he's not going to stay faithful? You know, he wouldn't be able to do that even if they did stay together? Like, wow. Again, kind of the anti-love song. The most important line in each of the stanzas is the fourth to last, the one that sets up the final rhyme. Someone who will die for you and more. Dylan always leans into the line that's in that position. And that's the continual gut punch of the song, how it really drives the point home at the end of each stanza. So for instance, the first one, someone to open each and every door. But it ain't me, babe. No, no, no. Da-da-da. It ain't me you're looking for. Second verse, the one we're on now, someone who will die for you and more. But it ain't me, babe. Etc. And then we'll skip ahead to the last one, a lover for your life and nothing more. But it ain't me, babe. No, no, no. It ain't me, babe. It ain't me you're looking for, babe. And now let's go back to the part we were focusing on. Someone to close his eyes for you. Someone to close his heart. Someone who will die for you and more. Just like with the no, 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 the someone, someone, someone is purposeful. And someone is a word that by definition, by use, is about somebody else. So not me, right? So it's reinforcing the point that he's not the one. Someone who will die for you and more, I think, is the best line in the song. It's, you know, it hits really hard when you hear it, but you have to stop and think about it for a second. Like, what more could there even be to give up than your life? That's the ultimate sacrifice. The song repeatedly hammers away at the unrealistic and unattainable expectations that his lover has for him, and no more so than in that line. And the song isn't just a case of, I don't want to be these things for you. It's, you want these things, which are impossible. And yet, ironically, they are what, like, all the love songs are about, and pretend is reality. And we've pointed out multiple times that the song's divided into three equal sections. Well, they're each structured the same way, and they each have the same three pieces within them. Part one, he tells her to go away. Part two is always about the expectations, which leads to that closure that we talked about every time in each of the three. Well, let's show one of Bob's paintings now, just to mix it up. When you actually look at this song on paper, it does not look like a song. As is so often the case, especially in this part of his career, built more like a classical poem than a pop song. And as we've talked about so often before in this video series, and this was, you know, a finding of Dr. Christopher Rix's, that Dylan will do something lyrical to signal that something is different, and meaning the song is now going to wrap up. Which is, by the way, something you will notice in a lot of just popular music. But not always, probably not even often, and probably because the music itself makes it so obvious what's happening. And real quick, sorry, but whenever it does happen in pop music, it's always in the exact same place. And it usually comes off as a little trite to me because it's more like an admission that, yeah, we're just hitting you again with basically the same verse you've been hearing all song. And so here's this one little change to it as we go through it the last time. So it's very formulaic. And like I said, almost an admission that, yeah, we just don't have a lot of words in this song. We just keep recycling the same ones. And Dylan, of course, is not guilty of that. He pretty much goes as far in the other direction as possible. And his clue isn't that standard formulaic just reversal of a couple of words in the, you know, classic line of the song. It's more something like this. Let's take it from the top. Go melt into the night, babe. Everything inside is made of stone. There's nothing in here moving. And anyway, I'm not alone. The opening couplet, the first two times, was different in that it did start with go away, but go melt back into the night is definitely different from go lightly from the ledge, or go away from my window. Those two painted a very specific picture and stuck to the same metaphor. All of a sudden, this one's more abstract. Go melt back into the night. And the second line, instead of, as previously, always being about how she leaves, kind of her mode of transportation or whatnot, the speed, she's going on the ground, instead it's totally different. Everything inside is made of stone, which matches with there's nothing in here moving. So for the first time in the song, he focuses on himself instead of her, in this position, in these lines. And it's much more poetic and abstract. Notice the juxtaposition here, too. Go melt back into the night, like she's insubstantial or becoming it, and meanwhile, he's made of stone. That's a beautiful and very easy to overlook. I bet you've never noticed it before. I guess I'll use the same word, juxtaposition. And as far as her trying to reach him, he might as well be a statue. He's made of stone. There's nothing in here moving. Then you take the line, and anyway, I'm not alone. It definitely stands out. It's like nothing else that came before it. And really, all of the previous lines are solely about Dylan and his now ex-lover. And this introduction is part of that break that I was talking about that kind of indicates that things are different now in terms of the song itself. And it adds yet another jab. Like, it's not that I've turned to stone, I don't feel anything anymore for anyone. No, just not for you. I can still be myself and gregarious and happy with these other people. And then things continue along the same lines as previous stanzas. You say you're looking for someone who'll pick you up each time you fall, so back to the expectation. To gather flowers constantly, and to come each time you call. And this is pretty intense, challenging stuff. Whenever the song shreds the typical love song conventions, it's not just that, it's also the typical kind of fairy tale romance, complete submission of self to the other myth that popular culture in general pushes. How many songs are there about that where the narrator is just worshiping the woman that he's singing to? Or when the woman is singing, you just reverse the roles. There's plenty of those too. When, meanwhile, their actual relationship or relationships are quite a different story. And, you know, every romance movie ends with happily ever after, or seemingly everyone. And in contrast, Dylan in this song is saying, well, I don't want to give up all of myself for you and live solely for you. And it's not even a plea for compromise or finding some middle ground. No, it's, oh, if this is what you want, I'm gone. The final line after this, before what stands as a refrain in this song, is a lover for your life and nothing more. And that is how the song ends. On the whole, this is just a dynamite piece of songwriting. There's a reason musical greats like Johnny Cash loved it and played it, and why it still gets played by young artists today. And so much of Dylan's art has been about liberation. That's kind of a defining theme. First for others, you know, with the political songs, which he wouldn't want to call political songs, but they were, then for himself. And as this song illustrates, it also shows up in his relationship songs. And speaking of relationship songs, this one is more honest than like 99.99% of that genre.